Sound Words, Christian Magazine, Volumes 41-50. Republished by Irving Risch, host of Down to Earth but Heavenly Minded podcast. Exodus, the Book of Redemption and Relationship. A. Shepherd. We will go through the entire book in 24 parts. Part 4 of 24. The Call of the Deliverer. Exodus Chapter 3. The two previous chapters are in the main introductory in character and are of the greatest importance, as serving to bring into full relief the reason for the mighty and effective intervention of God on behalf of his earthly people, no less in grace than in power. The closing verses of the previous chapter provide us with a fitting introduction to this present chapter in which we view the call of the deliverer. Here we stand upon the threshold of events of the deepest interest and importance, for while these events in their historical sequence relate to God's earthly people, when translated into the language of grace, they are shown to be in their spiritual import, details of our own history as his heavenly people. A history transcending in depth and character, this wonderful story of God's earthly people as the antitype must needs transcend the type. From the Passover to the land, the wonderful and majestic dealings of God with a people whose weakness and inveterate waywardness gave him the greatest and most ample opportunities of demonstrating to the full the reality of all that is implicit in that remarkable declaration. For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God has chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than all the peoples, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you and would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen, from the hand of Pharaoh king of Egypt. Deuteronomy chapter 7 verses 6-8. They were the objects of his tender unceasing care, and the subjects of the display of his power and grace, and as such are our types, written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages are come. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 11. As another has expressed it so acceptably, what must we be to him who has written our history in the records of these bygone ages? Oh, may we adoringly accept the love and bow our hearts to receive the admonition. Previously we have looked at Israel's deliverer from Egyptian bondage. We have seen him given over to death and delivered out of it. We have seen him presenting himself, prematurely no doubt and in the energy of nature, as the savior of his people, only to be summarily rejected by them. Then, as rejected by his own people, he obtains a wife in the place of his strangership, who bears him a son to whom he gives the name of Gershom. A stranger there, thereby indicating the deep feelings of his heart as one who had been a stranger in a strange land. May we see with ever-expanding vision the precious lineaments of one, peerless, incomparable, sovereign among all the great personages whom God has raised up as types of him of whom Moses has borne witness. A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up to you out of your brethren like unto me, him shall ye hear in everything whatsoever he shall say to you. Acts chapter 3 verse 22. Now we are called to witness in Exodus chapter 3, the call of the deliverer, precious and convincing proof the unforgetting heart of God in his remembrance of his earthly people. At the close of the second chapter these poignant words are recorded, and the children of Israel sighed because of the bondage, and cried, and their cry came up to God because of the bondage. And God heard the groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob, and God looked upon the children of Israel and took knowledge of their state. Exodus chapter 2 verses 23-25. As already remarked, these verses furnish us with an appropriate introduction to chapter 3, since in the seventh verse of this chapter we have the wonderful declaration on the part of God, in which we would reverently remark, he lays bare the deep feelings of his heart toward his earthly people in their state of cruel bondage, and so he exclaims, I have seen assuredly the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. And their cry have I heard on account of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land, unto a good and spacious land, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. God in his deep compassion heard their cry. It does not appear to have been directly or expressly addressed to God, rather it was the cry of hopelessness and despair, no ray of hope to assuage the sense of utter wretchedness. No expectation of some measure of alleviation or eventual deliverance from their state of abject misery and crushing bondage, no looking out to God or counting on his mercy. But God is faithful. How blessed for us that he is so. God heard their cry, he saw their state, and he had come down to deliver them. And so again he says in Exodus chapter 3 verse 9, and now behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me. And I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. And now come, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Let us put these statements together and see how in such a remarkable combination they present us with a thought of tremendous import. In verse 8, God says, I am come down to deliver them. Then in Exodus chapter 3 verse 10 he says, and now come, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people. O depth of riches both of the wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable his judgments and untraceable his ways! Truly his thoughts are not our thoughts, his ways are not our ways. God in sovereign wisdom had chosen one whose subsequent actions marked him as being weak and incompetent, yet God would be with his servant, investing him with power and authority in such manner and in such measure that the excellency of the power would be seen to be of God and not of the instrument he had chosen to be the deliverer of his people. And also to demonstrate that God's impressive announcements to Pharaoh was no vain assertion. And for this very cause have I raised thee up to show thee my power, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Exodus chapter 9 verse 16. Let us now look at Moses in the circumstances in which he is found when God appears to him as he tended the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. And as he led the flock behind the wilderness and came to the mountain of God, to Horeb. The singular designation, the mountain of God, is no doubt intended by the Spirit to arrest our attention that we too might turn aside and contemplate with reverential gaze and becoming attitude. The amazing scene opened out before us in relation to the call of Moses to the high destiny that lay before him. It is worthy of note that there are two other mountains specially referred to as mountains of God, Moriah and Zion. And it is not without significance that the truth connected with each stands indubitably connected with God's remarkable ways in grace and power with his earthly people. Moriah, Jah provides, was the place where the burnt offering would be divinely provided. And is this not the basis of all God's ways in grace and blessing? Horeb was the place where God made himself known in grace and faithfulness as the one who would deliver his people from the house of bondmen, and bring them into the inheritance he had assigned to them. Zion, beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth, will be the seat of government in the kingdom in a future day when all that God had pledged at Horeb will be fully accomplished. And all will rest upon and be secured by the value and sweet savor of Christ as the burnt offering. In Mount Moriah we get the righteous basis of God's ways in grace. In Horeb we get the character of those ways and the glorious fruition in Zion. With reference to God's ways of mercy and faithfulness to his earthly people, it might be well to state that while the heart of God was deeply moved by the groans and sighs of the people in their seemingly hopeless condition, the time and manner of his acting for the deliverance was in faithfulness to the promise he had made to Abraham many years before. In Genesis chapter 15, we have the remarkable vision given to Abraham in answer to his question, Lord God, whereby shall I know that I shall inherit it, when God had declared to him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. God then instructs Abraham to take me a heifer of 3 years old, and a she-goat of 3 years old, and a ram of 3 years old, and a turtle dove and a young pigeon. And he took all these and divided them in the midst, and laid the half of each opposite its fellow, but the birds he did not divide. And the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, and Abram scared them away. And as the sun was just going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and behold a horror, a great darkness fell upon him. And he said to Abram, Know assuredly that thy seed will be a sojourner in a land that is not theirs, and they shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. But also that nation which they serve will I judge. And afterwards they shall come out with great property. And it came to pass when the sun had gone down and it was dark that behold there was a smoking furnace, and a flame of fire which passed between those pieces. Genesis chapter 15 verses 9 to 18. In verses 9 and 10 we have what is figurative of the death of Christ. Everything for the blessing of the earthly and heavenly seed rests upon this inviolable foundation. God will assuredly establish his covenant, fulfill all his promises and bring in faith's inheritance through that precious and ever efficacious death. It is not through any goodness or works on the part of Abram or the seed, neither is it brought to pass without deep exercise on their part. how necessary that God should discipline his people and pass them through the furnace in order to bring them into the realization of how necessary for them is the death of Christ. God is seen here as the smoking furnace, the refiner of his people, and he refines according to the manner in which he dealt with sin in the cross of Christ. What he judged in the cross he must refine from his people in the crucible of affliction so that nothing may be left that is unsuited to the inheritance. Scripture abounds with references to the refining processes God uses in the purifying of his people. He says in Isaiah chapter 48 verse 10, I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. They needed the purifying fire in which God was, for what were the Egyptians? They had their part in what the fire symbolized. Nevertheless, it was the covenant-keeping God who was dealing with his people in love, a holy love, and in the pursuance of his purposes concerning them. God was using the fury of man to praise him, in carrying into effect his purposes concerning those they held in bondage. We see a similar instance to this in Isaiah chapter 10, where God says of the Assyrian, the Assyrian, the rod of mine anger, and the staff in their hand is mine indignation. In Isaiah chapter 8, God speaks to his people as having refused the waters of Shiloah which flow softly. He declares that in judgment he will bring up upon the waters of the river, strong and many, the king of Assyria and all his glory. And again in Isaiah chapter 28, this same power is referred to as the overflowing scourge. Reverting to the vision God gave to Abram, we see that the smoking furnace and the burning lamp are what the deep sleep and the darkness demand. And these the sacrifice secures and the faithfulness of God supplies to his people. If the activity and vigilance of faith fail, the furnace of trial will not fail as the appointed means of purification, while for the darkness which is the result of unbelief, the lamp or flame of fire is equally provided. How blessed to see in all this that the fiery trial through which they were passing in Egypt was but the precious indication of God's remembrance of his covenant. To unbelief it might seem otherwise, but to faith the stormy winds are but the fulfilling of his will. Only as we realize how great has been our bondage to sin, the world and Satan, can we rejoice in the wonderful deliverance that has been effected for us. How sure the inheritance to those whom God is thus pledged in Christ to bring them through to enjoy it, securing in his death those conditions which his holiness of necessity imposes. So that he can rest in all the joy of that which is the fruit of his own grace. It is not without significance that Moses is found here in the character of a shepherd. For 40 years those features were being formed which would make him eminently suited to shepherd the people of his pasture and sheep of his hand, for 40 years in the wilderness. A shepherd was the type of the divine deliverer and king. David, the man after God's own heart, is the great example among men. In Psalm chapter 78 it says, And he chose David his servant, and took him from the sheepfolds. From following the suckling ewes, he brought him to feed Jacob his people and Israel his inheritance. And he fed them according to the integrity of his heart and led them by the skillfulness of his hands. And what of him who is the true shepherd of the sheep, David's son, yet David's Lord? We have that beautiful quotation from Micah chapter 5 verse 2 enshrined in Matthew chapter 2 verse 6. And thou Bethlehem, land of Judah, art in no wise least among the governors of Judah. For out of thee shall go forth a leader who shall shepherd my people Israel, and in Micah it is added, whose goings forth are from of old, from the days of eternity. That is God's thought of a true ruler. Moses was trained for 40 years as a simple shepherd until he is fit to be the instrument in the hand of God to lead his people out of the house of bondmen, and also to tend and nourish them in the wilderness. And he of whom Moses is but a shadowy picture, true shepherd of the sheep, will never, however different the circumstances, give up the service to which love consecrated him. With love, rule is service, and how blessed the time when love alone shall rule. We find Moses then in the course of his service leading his flock to the back side of the desert and coming to Horeb, which was from henceforth to be called the mountain of God, in virtue of what was now to take place. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked and behold the bush burned with fire. And the bush was not consumed. This might well be a source of great wonder to natural eyes, but God does not appear to men in any spectacular way in order to satisfy their idle curiosity. Though sovereign in all his movements, yet he does not use this sovereignty in an arbitrary manner, but is sovereignly wise as is so convincingly shown in all his gracious appearings to men. for he displays himself in perfect suitability to the purposes before him, and this wonderful sight which Moses saw was no exception. God had before, in reference to this very captivity in Egypt, revealed himself in symbol as the smoking furnace when, in confirming his covenant with Abraham, he had passed between the pieces of the sacrifice. Now if we consider this thorn bush, for such it is a striking picture of the children of Israel. In Isaiah, chapter 10, the prophet in speaking of the Assyrian scourge says, "And the light of Israel shall be for a fire and his Holy One for a flame. And it shall burn and devour his thorns and his briars in one day." Thorns too were the sign of the curse at the beginning. They are in fact, as botanists tell us with special reference to the kind we have here, abortive leaves, parts of a plant incapable of fulfilling their original purpose. Such were the children of Israel, and such were we in our place of death and distance from God, connected in this symbol with the curse upon sin. But how great is the mercy of a Savior God! The thorn bush is not consumed. It was when we were living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another, that the kindness and love to man of our Savior God appeared, not on the principles of works which have been done in righteousness which we had done, but according to his own mercy he saved us. Titus chapter 3 verses 3-7. So with this burning bush it was meant to be an image of that which would indicate to Moses that God was about to work in the midst of Israel. He would prove himself a consuming fire, Moses and they must know it, for on the one hand, as surely as he is a consuming fire, so on the other. The bush, so weak and ready to vanish away, nevertheless remains to prove that whatever the sifting and judicial dealing of God, and the trials and searchings of man, when he displays himself in mercy as well as in power, he sustains the object, turning all to his account for good, no doubt for his own glory, but consequently for the best interests of those who are the objects of his mercy. But now we see one whom God had chosen as the instrument of his power in the deliverance of his people manifesting the backwardness of nature, just as he had displayed the forwardness of nature on an earlier occasion. The voice of God, now urging him forward to the execution of the great and glorious mission with which he had been entrusted. A mission authenticated by the authoritative word of God, in whom were those sovereign resources of almighty power which faith ever draws upon for the achievement of what is impossible to nature. How beautifully this is exemplified in Hebrews chapter 11, where in that illustrious crowd of witnesses, faith is displayed in all its diversity of expression. Caleb too lends his reassuring testimony. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses, and said, "Let us go up boldly and possess it, the land, for we are well able to do it. If the Lord delight in us, he will bring us into this land, and give it us," Numbers chapter 13 verse 30, Numbers chapter 14 verse 8. And what of David's powerful challenge as he advanced with his sling and stones to meet Goliath encased in all the panoply of war? "I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel whom thou hast defied," 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 45. But Moses had his eye on self, and in the event this was a weakness to which Moses was prone, usually attended with serious consequences for himself. Yet providing an ever faithful God with fresh occasions of displaying himself in the plenitude of his grace, rising above the failure of his servant in new and ever unfolding aspects of his glory. And so to all the objections and difficulties pleaded by Moses as proof of his unfitness for the signally great and distinctive honor which God was conferring upon him as the deliverer of his people, God makes this remarkable declaration of his name, as expressive of who he was and also as indicating the relationship in which his people stood to the one who had espoused the cause. To Moses' question therefore, "Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers hath sent me unto you, and they shall say, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" God makes this remarkable pronouncement, "I am that I am, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel. I am hath sent me unto you." The fact that God does not declare at this point what he is going to do gives added force to these words, for the declaration of himself as the ever-present, ever-existing one gives reality and meaning to his unchangeable purposes concerning his people, so that it could be said of him, "For the gifts and calling of God are not subject to repentance," Romans chapter 11 verse 29. And again in Malachi chapter 3, "For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore ye sons of Jacob are not consumed." Implicit in this wonderful declaration, "I am that I am," was the assurance that all the resources of divine power were there to bring to fruition all that he had counseled for them. But he goes further and says, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob hath sent me unto you, this is my name forever. And this is my memorial unto all generations. He has taken a name in relationship to men which is to be his continual memorial. How beautifully the Spirit brings this before us in Hebrews chapter 11. Speaking of Abraham, as a stranger in the land of promise as in a foreign country, having dwelt in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise, but now they seek a better, that is a heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed of them to be called the God. In all this we can discern a wonderful expression of grace on the part of God to his people. He speaks of his essential being as the I am. He also declares the name in which he has taken his people into relationship with himself, so that Paul could say of them, as regards election beloved on account of the fathers, Romans chapter 11 verse 28. Thereby showing plainly that Israel shall be forever the center of God's ways, and of his purposes concerning the earth. As another has said, he loves and cherishes the name in which he has bound up the objects of his choice with himself. The Almighty is the name God took with Abraham, the one in whom were the resources of power to sustain the weak pilgrims of faith in their earthly pilgrimage. I am, or Jehovah, which he took with Israel, as indicating to his failing people the unfailing character of his purpose concerning them. None of these in themselves declare his nature or the character of his ways with us. How inconceivably great, therefore, is the revelation of the Father by the Son who has said, I have made known to them thy name and will make it known. How this leads into an intimacy of individual relationship with the Father. A place of nearness and intimacy which alone can be measured by the wondrous fact that we have been brought into a place of grace and favor in the Beloved. And this was realized when as man he took his place in the Father's presence after declaring, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Moses is then warned that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, unless it be by a powerful hand. God then assures Moses that this will be distinctly manifested, as Paul again says, For this very thing I have raised thee, Pharaoh, up from amongst men, that I might thus show in thee my power, and that my name should be declared in all the earth. So then to whom he will he shows mercy, and whom he will he hardens, Romans chapter 9 verses 17-18. Well might Moses and the children of Israel celebrate in their song of triumph on the other side of the Red Sea the glorious achievements of the God and say, Thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, hath dashed in pieces the enemy. Exodus chapter 15 verse 6. Then every woman is told to ask of her neighbor's various articles, and ye shall spoil the Egyptians. Inappropriately the word borrow appears in the authorized version where the simple meaning, to ask, is intended. And according to his manner the rationalist has been quick to seize upon this word to charge God with enjoining his people to commit an immoral and dishonest act. There is not, however, the slightest infringement of what is right and proper, as the children of Israel had received no recompense for the harsh and bitter servitude which had been imposed upon them, and in the event. At the actual moment when the request was made, the Egyptians showed a conspicuous willingness to accede to their request, and the Egyptians urged the people to send them out of the land in haste, for they said, We are all dead men. And the Lord had given the people favor in the eyes of the Egyptians, and they gave to them, and they spoiled the Egyptians, Exodus chapter 12 verses 33, 36. It was an unconditional gift, savoring somewhat of an act of propitiation in the sure knowledge that they would see the children of Israel no more. The God of the Hebrews had taken up the gauge of battle thrown down by the haughty and insolent Pharaoh when he defiantly exclaimed, Who is the Lord, that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go, Exodus chapter 5 verse 2. But the God of their salvation had answered the proud Pharaoh by terrible things in righteousness, and, as he stood in the midst of the devastation which the desolating judgments of God had brought upon Egypt, he was made to realize, as was also Nebuchadnezzar at a later time, that the Most High ruleth over the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever he will, and those that walk in pride he is able to abase, Daniel chapter 4 verse 32, 37. When he makes bare his arm, who shall his work withstand? When he his people's cause defends, who then shall stay his hand?